Hi, I'm Peter Bohush.
And I'm Bill Fitzgerald.
We're here today in Old Sturbridge Village in Sturbridge, Massachusetts.
That's right. Old Sturbridge Village is a living history of what American life was like around 1830.
It's a living museum, and we're going to explore some of the facets of this really exciting place. Should we take a look?
Let's go take a look, Peter.
All right, let's do it. Well, Bill, this place is incredible. I've never been here before. Can you tell me a few of the things that we can see today?
Well, Peter, there's just so much going on at Sturbridge Village. They've got a carding mill, they've got a sawmill, they've got a lawyer, they've got a school teacher, they've got a banker.
Well, those are a couple things I'd like to see. I'd like to see what a bank was like, a lawyer, a schoolhouse. I know you'd probably like to take a look at the mills.
I'd like to take a look at the sawmill, see how that actually all works with the water power.
All right. Well, why don't we go our separate ways and we'll catch up later.
I'll catch up with you later, Peter.
Well, come in and look around. You're in a country store.
Mr. Allen's a proprietor of the country store here. What would people be coming in for, some staples that they'd be shopping for?
Well, at this time of year, you'd start to wonder about your wools.
Okay.
This is a time when textile factories are in operation, and there's a lot of textiles, both cottons for the summer and wools for the winter.
And how many of the products in the store would be made here in the U.S.? And how many would be have been imported from other parts of the world?
You get all your spices would be imported. Some of your textiles from India and China, the silks, would be imported. The cottons and the wools would be local. Massachusetts, Connecticut. Your tinware would be local.
Okay. Example of that, perhaps right here?
Right there is a nutmeg grater.
What
they call a spice grater.
Okay.
That you could grate nutmeg when you're cooking. Because it doesn't come all pre-done like it does today.
Yeah, okay, that's good.
And we have also here is Dr. Moore's Essence of Life. If you're feeling poorly in the morning, Dr. Moore's Essence of Life will just spruce you right up. If you don't feel poorly, Dr. Moore's Essence of Life will still spruce you up. It'll cure what you have and cure what you don't have. It's about 80% alcohol and with herbs and things like that.
I see. There's kind of a big horsefly floating upside down with a very happy look on its face. And
oh, well, I'm sure. Yeah.
La Vida Loca here, right? With this. Great. And one last thing. I pull this off. This is also a music shop in town, right? Do you have things?
Well, there's some things that you play, a musical instrument that you would put on your mouth. And watch out for your teeth, that you don't hit your teeth. Because if you hit your teeth, you will know it.
Sure.
And it will make a different sound with your mouth opening and closing.
You know any tunes? Give Me All Your Lovin' and Freebird?
Not me, no.
All right.
I have my own teeth, sir. Thank you.
All right. Well, I'll tell you what. I'd like to take one of those chewing tobaccos and move on down the road here.
Chew like this, take it off. You have a tobacco twist that you could chew, or you can have the leaf that you might make a cigar, or you can buy some cigars from Havana over here.
Yeah, I think I'm just going to buy a patch and continue with my progress of getting off stuff. Thanks very much.
You're welcome. Bye.
As a schoolmaster, or if it's a woman, schoolmistress, you're defined as keepers of children. You're guiding them to help them learn for the parents. Our system of education all of you are familiar with does not exist yet in America. It's still in the future. We don't even use the definition of child or children the way you do until the early 1840s. So when a child is born into a household, they're treated as little adults and they get full measure of adult punishment from a very young age up. And if you see paintings of children, they're usually portrayed as adults, not necessarily as children. So,
do as well as you can and do no harm. Mark the man that doth well and do so too. Help such as want help and be kind. Let your sins past put you in mind to mend.
Very good.
Well, I was such a good boy doing my memorization in school, the schoolmaster sent me down to the potter to get a new inkwell and some new quills. This is looking kind of shabby. So we're here at basically the pottery barn of Old Sturbridge Village. We're going to watch a potter make some of these inkwells.
So this guy was a farmer who did this on the side. as a way to make a little extra money. And that's all it is. So we would be just sending our sons out, having them dig up the clay. It's just a regular backyard river soil. And then just step again. So the first step in the process is to cone the clay up and get it right into the middle of the wheel. So I'm just squishing between my hands. Now, once you get it in the middle, I'm going to bring this inside tube up first. So I'm just going to push in with my inside and outside hand. See how that's just coming up right between my fingers? Now I'm going to pull this outside up and around, and that's where your feather pens will go. So we'd get about 600-800 pots ready before we'd fire the kiln across the road, that big brick oven. So it takes about 3 to 5 cords of firewood to reach 1800-1900 degrees. And then smooth it out with my sponge, like so. And then I'm just gonna take my tool here, has a little groove in it, and what that does is puts the foot on the bottom of the pot. That's just putting that groove there. And that's just something to grab it by when I dip it in the glaze. And there's another one. And then after they dry for a few minutes, then I can take my good old pointy stick and I can poke the holes on the outside for where the quills go. And a third one. There it is. There's another inkstand or inkwell.
Like most people in the 1830s, New Englanders needed to be self-sufficient. They had to plow their own fields, raise and slaughter their own livestock, and grow their own vegetables and harvest them. In New England, the gardens would consist mainly of root crops like beets and turnips, parsnips and carrots, some beans, some potatoes and cabbages, and a few other things. So let's go take a look inside this garden and see what they're getting ready to harvest. So Reese, as a farmer here at Old Sturbridge Village, what are some of your responsibilities that you need to do?
Well, the first thing that we have to do is we have to take care of the animals. We have many different animals on our farm here. And then, of course, we are interpreters, so we have to interpret an 1830s farm. So we are talking with the public a good deal amount of time. And then, of course, we have to find time to manage a garden like this. This would be a family garden, a vegetable garden. And then we also have to manage the fields with our corn, rye, and oats.
Well, that's a full slate there. So you have about a quarter acre here for your family garden. Mm-hmm. And there's a row of beets in the back there. Mm-hmm. And we've got some other squashes and things. Now it's harvest time, so many things have just been harvested, but we have some parsnips here.
Right here we have a parsnip. I'll just pull this up out of the ground. This is a fairly good size one. We were pulling up ones that were probably about 6 inches longer than this before. But this is this looks a lot like a white carrot.
Yep.
And it tastes much like that as well, a little bit milder taste to it. What you'd do is you'd cut this here and then you'd store it in your root cellar.
All right, so it smells like a carrot. It actually smells quite good. Any use for the leaves at all? They're spices, herbs, anything like this?
You could throw them into the pigs. The pigs are what gets a lot of the scraps left in the garden.
All right. And how long would this keep in the wintertime?
It would keep through the winter. It would keep all the way until next spring and into the summer even, because you're only harvesting in the fall, so your vegetables have to last from fall to fall. Right. So they would keep for probably 8 to 10 months or so.
Well, we have some beans and some pumpkins and squash. Let's go take a look at those, too. Doesn't this look like a nice... I love rhubarb, so that's what I'm always looking for. But this is not, because down on the bottom, we see a root growing there and a bulb of something.
Yeah, this is a manglewort. It's a type of... It's in the beet family. And this would be generally used for animal feed. So what you'd do is you'd throw the entire thing in to the pig pen, and generally you'd have probably two or three rows full of these. So you would keep your pigs and your cattle well fed throughout, right, throughout the fall.
I've never seen the manglewort at the grocery store, so I'm assuming this is not people food, right?
Nope.
All right, now behind us we've got a purple cabbage.
Yep.
Growing here?
Absolutely. This one, the head hasn't been developed quite yet. A lot of times the head is much wider. But it's, as you can see, we do have a little bit of problems with some of the beetles.
Okay, coming through here. Yep.
But
we see it. There's not a lot of defined rows. It's just using every little inch of space, it seems, here on your garden. We've got some nasturtiums, the pretty orange and yellow flowers growing in here. Now behind us is really interesting. This kind of bean, tell me about what we've got here.
This is a scarlet runner bean, and we use a tripod so they can grow, because they're runner beans, so they grow up the poles. And what we're doing now is they're done growing, but they're drying out. And you can see the leaves are even drying out. So that means that the beans inside could be drying out, and then we'll bring it in and we'll hang it, and those dried beans we'll use all year long.
What do you think? Take a look at one of them here?
Yeah, absolutely.
All right, so we're going to pull one, and it's still a little moist here. It's not dried out. But whoops.
There they are.
Beautiful.
Yep. Man, it tastes great. But...
Yeah, well, let's give it a try. Mm. Okay. Where's our craft services table? This is like something out of Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon. This is a little, this is, looks dangerous. What are we looking at here? What is this?
Well, this is a flail, and this has a very useful function. It knocks the seed off of the stalk. And what we have here is we have buckwheat.
Buckwheat.
You can see it has some brilliant colors. It has some bright green and bright purple. And what I'm going to be doing is I'm going to be using this to knock off these triangular seeds off.
And what are you doing with the seeds when you knock them off? What's the purpose of that?
Then they're gonna fall down on the canvas that we have laid out here, and then we will collect it, put it into our barrel here, and then take it down to the grist mill, and then grind it up and use it for flour in the household for baking.
Okay, I'm gonna step back while you flail away.
And now it has shaft with it and a lot of the extra things laid with it, but you'll winnow that out.
Okay, winnow it.
Now winnowing it is using a big basket like this.
Okay.
And what you do is you toss it up in the air, the seed will fall down into the basket while the shaft will blow in the breeze. That's why we have this big breezeway in our barn.
So you need a breezy day to do winnow, to do winnowing. Okay, and here we are, flailing the buckwheat, fluffing, flailing, and winnowing.
Absolutely.
Just to get some stuff down to the grist mill.
Grist mill.
Should be a good place to visit.
Grind it up, and use it in the household.
Now, a congregational minister in 1830s New England would have been on the job maybe 5 or 6 years and then moved on to another congregation. This was different from the way it was in the 18th century, when ministers would hold that position for life. Now, they didn't get to live rent free. They would have to either purchase the building at $600 or $800 or rent it for $60 to $80 a year. Doesn't sound like much, but keep in mind that most ministers were earning about $500 a year, and that was payable at the end of their year of service. Thank you. So don't delay. Call 1-800-OLD-STURBRIDGE-VILLAGE and get the OSV's greatest hits on CD today. That was great. Thanks.
Thanks a lot.
These two are both Belgians. Yeah, the Belgians are the most popular draft horse breed in America today. I'm going to try to tell you a little bit about some of the history behind the village and some of the buildings as we go along. If you have any questions, please feel free to ask. This gentleman next to me would be glad to answer all your questions, okay?
These two are Pete and Dan. Pete's the horse on the left and Dan's the horse on the right. If I want to stop, I say whoa and they'll stop. If I want to throw it in reverse, tell them to back and they'll back up till I tell them to do something else. Just like kids. Oh, guys, wait. Careful, boys, easy.
Most of the buildings that you've seen around here today were brought in from other parts of New England to recreate a very small slice of the 1830s. They chose this site because we already had a grist mill site and a sawmill site. And this mill pond that you see down through the trees here to your left. And they wanted to show how water power influenced the 1830s as the start of the Industrial Revolution. This red building that sits back in the distance to your right is the Freeman Farmhouse. That house was only moved about a mile from its original site. It was right up where Route 84 came through Sturbridge. This little red building down here to your right is a carding mill. That's where farmers would bring their wool and have it combed out or processed into batting for quilts or rolls for spinning. That building is the old Hapgood Mill, originally from South Waterford, Maine. Over 4,000 sheep in the town of Sturbridge. Just 1,800 people.
Wool tends to bind to itself. You would take this off to your spinning wheel. The spinning machine is doing this. It's twisting the wool. So essentially what the machine is doing, the spinning machine, is twisting wool, and the spinner is pulling, and you're making that a thread. It's all about one thread. With that thread, you can knit into sweaters or caps, or you can put it on a hand loom, where you have threads going this way, that way, and a bobbin goes between, and a shuttle comes in, knocks that piece of that thread into the other, so you make cloth.
Can I take a look at this?
Sure.
This is from lambs.
Yes, from sheep.
From sheep, yeah. Mary had a little lamb. Okay, that's incredible. Thank you.
You're welcome. All
right. And these machines, though, they were manufactured in New England.
These were.
All right.
Originally, they were manufactured in England.
Right.
They were state secrets. You could not export parts or the machine or drawings from England. Do so as a capital offense punished by hanging.
So someone stole the blueprints of that? How did that happen?
What happened typically is that if you were a technician or a journeyman or an apprentice who worked in the textile industry in England, it was forbidden for you to leave the country too, along with the machines. But some of the apprentices disguised themselves as farmers and forged papers and left the country to come through America to see it.
Which
drawings.
So the blueprints was up here.
Exactly.
All right. And did they become successful industrialists? Or?
Oh, yes.
Yeah?
Samuel Slater probably is a good example. He was the apprentice to John Arkwright, who invented the power loom. He left England disguised as a farmer on a ship and came over here and teamed up with people with money and started Slater Mills in Rhode Island. Later to become a financier of other mills, and he became very, very wealthy.
Now, in order to have any type of mill, you need some sort of water power. So the gears and the mechanisms are all below here.
That's what you hear.
Okay.
That's the noise you hear. The water is coming in the race over here,
right,
going down through a bucket with a water paddles,
yep,
and it comes up through a leather belt on the drive of this size machine as it's turning this machine.
So this is really, in a way, the beginning of the Industrial Revolution with
correct
the use of water power for in mills.
That was the key.
Lowell, Lawrence,
yes,
Province.
That was the key. Yes. Yeah. That's why New England grew.
Even Worcester.
In Worcester, yeah. All New England. Any place with water power, it was a prime location for beginning of the Industrial Revolution because of the water pump.
Great. Well, thanks for your time here at Old Sturbridge Village. And we're going to go down below and take a look and see how this thing works.